tanks have come a long way from their early days of crossing trenches and dodging landmines. The most capable tanks of today, like the Leopard and Abrams, with their heavy guns and targeting systems, more and more resemble battleships crawling on land. The question is whether these behemoths, which have dominated the battlefield for over a century, are going extinct, or are they just evolving into something smaller? This question is posed by the war in Ukraine, where tanks are proving more vulnerable than ever, and that's due to technologies like the Javelin launchers and FPV drones. In Ukraine, the traditional tactics of open-field tank battles are proving less and less viable, with armored casualties mounting on both sides due to far more cost-effective methods such as ambushes and anti-tank infantry. But from these heavy losses, a new strategy is emerging for armored warfare: light and fast. Both the Russians and Ukrainians have begun to use lighter vehicles for their operations in the flat eastern steppe of Ukraine. One class of vehicles specifically, the Infantry Fighting Vehicle, or IFV, is stealing the spotlight from the heavier main battle tanks, and for good reasons. But why tanks need to lose weight, not so they can go faster, but to stay relevant. How the M1 Abrams gained its legendary status somewhat unfairly, and why IFVs are stealing the spotlight in the Ukraine war, to the extent that having Bradleys might be more effective than having F-16s, is not what you think. The legendary status of the Abrams main battle tanks were cemented over 30 years ago in a battle during the Persian Gulf War between the United States and Iraq. This engagement, known as the Battle of Medina Ridge, lasted 2 hours, during which the US Army forces annihilated almost 200 Iraqi T-72 tanks while losing only 4 Abrams tanks. Early on after the battle, many historians would go on to credit the superior armor and targeting technology of the Abrams for this resounding success. But there is one pretty big detail that's often left out about this battle, which is that the Americans had total air supremacy and could use their A-10 Warthogs and AH-64 Apaches to overwhelm the Iraqi tanks. It is this detail that is missing today in Ukraine, since neither the Russians nor the Ukrainians can mount and maintain a continuous air campaign for air supremacy. For the Russians, it's a lack of resources and parts to maintain their aircraft, while for the Ukrainians, it's a lack of aircraft and qualified pilots to fly them. Without air superiority, protecting tanks from infantry ambushes and anti-tank weapons is difficult, since there's no element of suppression or reconnaissance from the air. But there's also another wrinkle with protecting tanks. Even with air superiority, the development of drones has made it nearly impossible for tanks to hide on the battlefield, since operators can fly low-profile commercial drones and spot them from anywhere. Once a tank is spotted, it's easy for enemy soldiers to use anti-tank weapons or another drone to take it out, which has led to the steady losses of tanks since the start of the conflict. But just because armor is becoming more vulnerable doesn't mean it's becoming obsolete. And it's with these changing conditions that vehicles like the American M2 Bradley and the Russian BMP-3 are beginning to shine. Even though the news would have you believe that the answer to all of Ukraine's troubles is F-16s and Abrams supertanks, the truth is really something less extreme. This is because the Russo-Ukrainian war is a slow crawl of attrition, rather than the typical short-shock conflicts common in the 21st century. And in a war of attrition, preserving infantry is a critical objective. That's why the Bradley Infantry Fighting Vehicle has become the star of the show for Ukrainian forces, with some even claiming they owe their lives to its support. Since January 2023, the United States has been sending variants of the M2 Bradley to support Ukrainian counteroffensive operations, and reports from soldiers who have both driven and ridden inside the IFVs have begun to reveal its exceptional abilities to resist mines, attack drones, and mortars, which gives us a clue about these vehicles' real purpose in Ukraine. Since troop movements and vehicle movements are now so hard to conceal from drones, the factor that contributes to an operation's success is the survivability of the movement. This was the purpose for the Bradley's development in the first place, as a troop carrier that can safely deliver and disembark infantry to the site of a battle. But how does Bradley keep his passengers safe? And how come its survivability is better than most tanks currently in combat? Well, it's for a combination of reasons. First, the Bradley's main focus is to preserve the lives of its passengers. So the Ukrainian variant uses the Bradley Urban Survival Kit, or BUSK for short. BUSK gives the vehicle a high-intensity spotlight, a wire mesh to protect the optics, non-conductive arched strips of nylon for downed power line protection, additional armor on the underside with integral reactive armor, and internal anti-spalling lining to prevent shell and armor fragments from injuring passengers. The BUSK variant also comes with software for detecting when components and sensors are damaged, along with a training simulator to help prepare the gunner. Second, the Bradley is not an attractive of a target during offensive engagements when supported by heavier tanks, since its weapons are mainly intended to support its infantry passengers while they disembark. This leads the enemy to focus on the surrounding vehicles with more firepower, resulting in lower Bradley casualties when supported by heavier armor. Finally, the Bradley is fast and agile. It can go up to 40 miles per hour and runs on a torsion bar suspension. Its use of aluminum in the chassis and armor means a lighter impact when crossing rough terrain, which decreases the risk of damage during high-speed, sudden maneuvers. With this agility, the driver and gunner of Bradley can focus on staying on the move when in combat, which decreases the chances of being destroyed by a drone or anti-tank missile. And when the Bradley eventually runs into a tank, it has a trick up its sleeve to survive even that. A tow missile launcher capable of handling almost any tank the Bradley might face in Ukraine. The design of the Bradley is not an entirely original concept, however. In fact, the main reason why the US focused so heavily on developing the infantry fighting vehicle platform was in response to the Soviet Union's BMP series of vehicles. Though not nearly as complex in design as today's Western IFVs, the Soviet BMP-1 was a revolutionary concept when it was first introduced in the late 1960s. Designed with aggressively sloped frontal armor and a low-profile silhouette, it kept troops relatively safe from small arms fire and artillery fragments. This was a product of the Soviets' experience in World War II, where safe movement of troops alongside main battle tanks proved critical in overwhelming the enemy. The design of BMP-1 also focused on simplicity, since it was meant to be produced in mass numbers. Along with the BMP-2 and BMP-3, BMP-1 is the most common vehicle on the battlefield in Ukraine, since the BMP series is used by both sides of the war. So, if the IFVs are the main character in this modern war, why does everyone talk about tanks so much? Well, the first reason is because Russia has a lot of tanks, and I mean a lot. Many analysts believe that Russia has around 1,300 modern battle tanks in active service, but nearly 10,000 older and technically obsolete tanks in reserve. While these thousands of vintage T-62s and T-55s may not be up to today's tank standards, they still have heavier armor and weaponry than any IFV out there today. So the best way to fight a tank is still with another tank. Javelins and drones are strong defensive anti-tank weapons, but during an offensive operation, heavy tanks are needed to push through the enemy's defense. The second reason is that tanks provide a significant advantage in urban combat, since they're more likely to survive combat within a city due to their heavier armor and cannon, which is significantly more effective against building positions. So for Ukraine, more heavy battle tanks means more resources to push back the occupying Russian forces. But tanks are always changing, because the design of a tank is a constant push and pull between the mission a tank is built for and how well it survives that mission. For example, Western tanks like the Abrams, Challenger, and Leopard all have a common design layout, a large turret and wide body, which makes them a large target. They are fast, but heavy, and they drink fuel like crazy. Russian tanks focus more on reducing their silhouette. They are lower to the ground and have small turrets, many of which replace a crew member with an auto-loading device. Both Western and Russian tanks operate in direct combat, generally in standalone formations and with the intention of clearing the way for a combat infantry force. But with the lack of consistent air support in Ukraine, this doctrine has been difficult to implement. So tanks are currently taking on more flexible missions, like probing attacks and reconnaissance. With these developments, many countries are beginning to turn toward finding the middle ground between IFVs and tanks. Two examples of this are the newest American tank, the M10 Booker, and China's Type 15. With the US Army's M10, the focus has been weight loss, with a new standard weight of 38 metric tons, nearly half of the Abrams' 67 tons. This weight reduction for the Booker is because the Abrams tank is too heavy for airborne doctrine and cannot be transported very easily. The new M10 also features a slightly smaller 105mm gun, rather than the M1's new 120mm cannon. With this, the Booker has access to a wider variety of shell types, since 105mm is far more common among NATO tanks than 120mm shells. These specs are incredibly similar to the Chinese Type 15, which also uses a 105mm gun and reportedly weighs 33 to 36 metric tons. Much of the reasoning behind the design of these two tanks is similar, since the lighter a tank is, the easier it is to transport it to and from the battlefield. Lighter tanks also have advantages when operating at higher altitudes, since their engines need less oxygen to power the vehicle. They are also much easier for amphibious transports to land on beaches. Even beyond these two tanks, some IFVs are also getting closer in design to the tank. Take, for example, the new German Puma IFV, which is an improvement on the Marder class and uses an auto-loading turret. Just like the M10 and the Type 15, this armored fighting vehicle blurs the operational line between troop carrier and armored support. All these newer vehicles point to the same direction in doctrine for the militaries of the future: light, mobile warfare centered around supporting infantry operations. So, are the mammoth tanks going extinct? The answer is no, at least for now, mostly because they're still highly effective at defending positions and breaking through them. But as missile and drone technologies continue to improve, the focus for tanks will be finding ways to stay on the move, rather than becoming target practice. This is no different from how cruise missiles change the way naval ships operate, or even how the bullet changed the amount of armor a soldier wears. As the projectile hitting you gets better at breaking your armor, the best defense is just avoiding it altogether.